Dr. Hawkins is a glaucoma specialist in Chicago. In fact, when I was a medical student, I rotated through a clinic with Dr. Hawkins when she was a resident. And one of the reasons why I was so excited to become an ophthalmologist and do glaucoma was because I got a chance to shadow Dr. Hawkins. And I remember thinking how much she loved interacting with her patients, how much time she took educating patients. And that was one of the reasons why I chose glaucoma, because it is a condition where it's a lifelong condition that you and the surgeon and your ophthalmologist are spending time together, not just one visit, but their whole entire life, coming back for follow-ups as well. And that kind of continuity of care, and when she exhibited was so impressionable on me that I decided to become a glaucoma specialist, partly because of her education and my experience with her. So I want to bring onto the stage Dr. Hawkins, who's going to talk about glaucoma as an overview. She's from Rush University and also is in private practice as a glaucoma specialist. So thank you for coming on stage to Dr. Anjali Hawkins.
Okay, well, thank you for, I feel so honored to be part of this panel and being invited to speak to you today. I was given a simple task to say, you know, basically, what is glaucoma? My practice mostly is in Geneva suburb, but I also teach at Rush. So in basic terms, when we talk to our patients every day and you tell them they have glaucoma and you explain everything, then right before they leave, they turn around and say, but doctor, what is glaucoma? And I just thought I spent 10 minutes explaining that, but then, you know, we kind of go over it again. It's, you know, each eye has one optic nerve, and it's a disease of the optic nerve, which gets damaged very slowly usually, but progressively and painlessly, so patients don't know they have a problem. And it's due, for the most part, due to high pressure in the eye. And this can lead slowly to damage to your peripheral vision, and in some cases, eventually to blindness. It's estimated that our population in 2030 is going to be close to 70 million. And the reason that's important is currently 3 million individuals have glaucoma, but that's going to be in the rise in the future. Up to 1 million individuals are even unaware that they may have this disease. And the reason is they're not used to going to the eye doctor. Maybe they don't need glasses or they're doing fine with what they have. 80,000 people are currently blind from glaucoma. So who gets glaucoma? What age group? Who is at risk? Number one, elderly, so over 65 years old. And there are certain races, like African Americans, that have a very severe form or almost a different form of this glaucoma in terms of it progresses more rapidly, more likely to have failure from surgery. And individuals, most importantly, with high intraocular pressure, IOP, are the ones that are at risk for glaucoma. We always ask you, anybody in your family have glaucoma? So if there's your mom or dad or other first-degree relatives with glaucoma, that puts you at risk. The other two things, myopia, which means being nearsighted or needing glasses at a young age, and diabetes. Now, it could be that these two groups tend to go to the eye doctor more because they need glasses, and the diabetic patients are always told by their primary care doctors to get an eye exam. So it could be that they're more likely to be tested for glaucoma, but there are studies that show independently that being nearsighted and having diabetes are indeed a risk factor for glaucoma. So the most important thing, the risk factor, the modifiable risk factor, is measuring intraocular pressure. And that's done with the slit lamp, the machine that your optometrist or ophthalmologist uses, with Goldmann tonometry. That's the blue tip that comes close to your eye and ever so gently touches it. That's the gold standard to measure pressure. However, there are other ways and techniques to measure that as well. So glaucoma is the second most common cause of visual loss in the elderly. It affects about 10% of African Americans that are over the age 70. In addition, it affects 2% of Caucasians. So the important part is early detection, treatment, to prevent blindness. So there's many types of glaucoma. I'm going to mostly talk about the most common kind called primary open angle glaucoma. There's angle closure glaucoma. And then there's uncommon types, congenital, childhood, and secondary. So the secondary means there's something else causing the glaucoma. For example, a history of trauma or arthritis in the eye, steroid use if you have asthma or any other arthritic conditions, diabetic retinopathy, or some sort of a vein occlusion or stroke in the eye. So those other ocular conditions can also lead to glaucoma, or sometimes even the treatment for other ocular conditions can lead to glaucoma. But the most common kind is known as POAG, primary open-angle glaucoma. It's bilateral, but not always symmetric. So it's very often we will see a patient for the first time and one eye has had damage and the other eye is perfectly normal, but we know it's a bilateral disease and it's a matter of time that the other eye will also show characteristics for glaucoma. Glaucoma has very characteristic optic nerve and visual field changes that we can see from our examination. So it's very hard to explain to patients when they say, well, how do you know I have glaucoma? You know, it's because I can examine you. You don't feel anything, your eyes are not red, you don't see anything different, but I know you have glaucoma. It's usually adult onset, and the part of the eye where fluid drains, what we call that the angles, looks very normal. However, the pressure is building up. In addition, there's no secondary causes. So we'll ask about, you know, are you on steroids? Do you take Flonase for allergies? Is there some steroid ointment you're taking? Because if there is a secondary cause, then that's easier in the sense that you can try to eliminate that or fix that secondary thing, and then glaucoma could be better. So this is a diagram of what the normal cartoon kind of diagram of what the normal eye looks like. Part of the eye that produces fluid is called the ciliary body. And that aqueous humor, that fluid that gives nutrition to the eye, has a way that it travels once it's produced and then exits. The exit pathway is called the Schlemm's canal, and the fluid has to go around the natural lens of the eye, over the iris, through that canal. And we can put a special lens on the eye called a Gonio lens and look at that canal. A lot of times it looks open. And in primary open angle glaucoma, even though that canal is open to the for me to look at, there's some obstruction in there for glaucoma patients where the fluid does not drain as readily as normally as it should. So there's a normal amount of fluid being made to give nutrition to the eye, but it is not exiting fast enough. So what happens is that fluid just builds up in the eye, causing elevated intraocular pressure. So because it's asymptomatic, patients don't come in, you know, my eye hurts, I have glaucoma, they can't feel anything. There's often a great amount of vision loss, at least in one eye, before a patient or an optometrist may notice that there is glaucoma. This is a picture of a very healthy optic nerve. Optic nerve looks good. The inside has a small white area called a cup that's normal looking. This is a picture of a glaucomatous optic nerve where the inside part that we call a cup is much larger, much deeper, and that's had considerable damage. This is normal, what a person that does not have glaucoma can see with one eye. There is, you know, certain number of degrees to the outside and towards the nose, up and down. And remember, both eyes are open. This is an eye that's losing some vision close to their nose as well as some central vision. But patients may not even notice this at all because the other eye could be totally normal and they can move their head and still see and function and drive and not have any trouble. So the test that everybody complains about daily is the visual field exam. That all patients know that, you know, they all want to be warned or make some excuse why they can't take it that time. But it's the single most important test that we do. because we still don't have a way of telling without your cooperation how much vision is being lost, what the rate of loss is. But if this test is done properly, we have a very good idea if we say your vision is stable or your glaucoma is stable. Because there could be patients that have very low pressure and their visual field is deteriorating. So that's a big deal to us, even if your pressure is 10 or 12, to do this to make sure the visual field is not getting any worse. This is an example of a visual field progression. The way you look at these diagrams, the first one here is anything in black or gray is something the patient didn't see. So if you've never taken one of these tests, the idea is to cover one eye up and one eye open. The patient is to look straight ahead, and lights are flashed in different areas in a random way with a random brightness. And we're checking if the patient sees it, they push a button. If they don't see it, the machine will come back and show it even brighter, so we get a good idea of what brightness was seen at what level. So when the doctor gets this printout, it shows them a plot of dark spots and gray spots. Those are the spots that were not seen. And as it progresses from the right to the left, you can see the very last one has a lot more dark spots, a lot more grayscale. So that gives us a clue that this glaucoma is worsening. So then as a doctor, the only thing that we can really modify is the pressure. If the pressure is not low enough, then the next step is more treatment, whether that's drops, laser, or surgery. So that's why this is the most important test when we say we really need a good quality visual field to see how the glaucoma is doing. So, you know, and why treat? This disease will keep marching on unless we can stop this visual field loss. Avoid further field loss, avoid optic nerve damage. We can use medications, laser, surgery, and any other interventions that we can think of to lower the pressure. And so sometimes patient compliance is a big deal. You know, just like you may floss your teeth many more times before you go to the dentist, we find that patients may take their drops more regularly or many more times before they see us. So often we can have recordings of normal pressure every time a patient comes in, yet they continue to deteriorate. So one reason could be compliance, and we always, you know, ask three times, well, which drop, which eye, are you sure you're doing it 12 hours apart? You know, do you wait 5 minutes? And it's redundant, but that's really part of the education where, you know, the technicians already asked, but I asked myself, you know, what color was that drop? Was it 8 p.m. or what? To sort of reiterate that this is really, really important. And I find patients that take it upon themselves to be part of the treatment, you know, what is better, to ask a lot of questions about timing and this and that. Those are the patients that I can help the most because they've taken ownership of their disease. So, you know, sometimes medical therapy doesn't work, as we talked about surgery. It's often some drops don't work for everybody, or people are allergic. There could be fluctuations. That's why you have to be seen every 3 or 4 months. We don't just say you're stable, come back in a year, because things can change rapidly. So to quickly touch on a different kind of glaucoma, that's called angle closure, and that's less common compared to the primary open angle glaucoma, but happens in the elderly, happens in patients that have short, far-sighted eyes. There tends to be a family history. Females are more likely because they probably have shorter eyes. Race that gets it a lot is the Eskimo group and Asians. So in this eye, in this condition, patients actually present with pain. They have nausea, eye pain, severe headache. Sometimes it's a very nonspecific, I don't feel good, abdominal pain. We hear stories about people going to the ER and having their appendix removed and things like that because emergency room doctors don't check vision or eye pressure, so that's happened. So going back to the same cartoon, basically the angle in this case is actually closed, and it just gets worse and worse because there's no way for that fluid to get around the iris, around the lens, and the pressure just continues to build. And this is building at a very fast rate versus weeks and months and years, so there is lots of pain with this. And the treatment tends to be laser, so you make a hole in the colored part of the eye like a release valve, and now there's a secondary way that the fluid can exit even if the Schlemm's canal is closed, and that seems to alleviate the problem almost right away. So if this is caught early, those patients may not have to be on any eye drops. It's just cured. And that's what it looks like, a little hole, kind of like a pupil. Here you'll see it at about 11 o'clock. It's done in the office. It hurts a little bit, but it's one and done. And then hopefully they don't, if the pressure's normal, they won't need drops again. This is, you know, another picture of what an optic nerve on the right side looks like, a big white part in the area, that's glaucoma, and the other one next to it's just very healthy. So, you know, in the end, just want to leave you with the fact that glaucoma can be controlled in the majority of cases, but there is yet to have a cure, but it can be very well treated and controlled. Thank you.